My long search is finally over. After scouting for years, I finally have one again, the IBM PC AT 5170. And it came with a heap of user manuals and even a second 5151 CRT screen. Not to mention lots of dust, burned capacitors and hours of restoration fun. Have you ever fixed an old computer? I did, many times. I'm the Vintage Collector and these are my stories. If there ever was machines outside the silicon graphics world that I was emotionally attached to, then it was my dad's high screen Kalani Tower, but also the IBM AT he owned many years prior. Needless to say, this once became my machine as my dad passed down his old gear. And while I eventually got rid of it in my younger years, it was a mistake I deeply regretted in my later years. But finally I found this fairly complete unit in Bavaria, Germany. While it blew the fuse during an early power on test and was missing the original Model M keyboard, it came with a heap of bundled software manuals, a printer and two 5151 MDA CRT displays. Originally released in 1984, the IBM AT was the fourth iteration after the IBM PC 5150, the IBM XT 5160 and the IBM PC Portable 5155. The latter had only been released 6 months prior to the PC AT, however still came with the Intel 8088 processor. The PC AT, on the other hand, featured the Intel 8286 CPU, originally clocked at 6 or 8 MHz, and a default onboard memory between 256 and 512 KB. But the 8286 was far more advanced, as not only did it introduce additional memory address lines, allowing for up to 16 MB of memory, but also the so-called protector mode, which let the system take advantage of this huge amount of RAM. But IBM also introduced culprits like the dreaded A20 gate, which allowed for switching off the 21st memory address line. This was needed for backwards compatibility for early real mode programs, which relied on the memory address wraparound. This wasn't really an issue for protector mode operating systems like OS2, Xenix and others. But boy, had they not done this hack for real mode compatibility, it either could have meant an early death for the IBM line of personal computers. But it might probably have spared intense headaches for developers and users alike as well for many years to come. While with the initial 512 kilobytes of base memory, it wasn't really an issue, it quickly became one, especially if you stocked up the RAM using expansion boards. And we'll be looking at one of those in a few moments. The AT also included advancements like an RTC clock, supported by a separate battery, which also kept the CMOS settings permanently stored, as the AT's BIOS was now also software configurable as opposed to its predecessors. And whereas the earlier models came with 8-bit expansion slots, the AT introduced the 16-bit AT bus, later just commonly referred to as the ISA bus. Plus it came with 1.2 MB 5 1/4 inch floppy drive and either a 20 or a 30 MB hard drive and supported a plethora of different graphics options. Prices started at $6,000, which is equivalent to around $19,000 in 2024. Now, Wikipedia claims there were more than 100,000 units produced. I think this is a very conservative understatement. The Silicon Underground claims that the original PC 5150 sold alone over 3.3 million units, the XT 5160 came in with over 2 million units and the AT 5170 reaching around 900,000 units. The original PC lineup is claimed to total for around 7.4 million PCs. From today's perspective of a worldwide market, this seems relatively small, but it was comparably huge for the period between 1981 and 1987. After all, given that apparently only a rough million of PC ATs may have been produced, one may wonder how many of them are still out there today. I was really lucky getting my hands on this machinery, especially as just days prior before seeing this one on sale, I had observed this other ridiculously high priced unit on eBay, which was even missing the entire power supply, drive cabling and some add-in cards and the peripherals. Big thanks to PCBWay for sponsoring this video. If you're working on an electronics project, PCBWay is a fantastic choice for high quality PCB production and full turnkey assembly, offering fast turnaround times and professional manufacturing, just like this excellent drive adapter they produced for my previous IBM P70 restoration project. Check them out at PCBWay.com and get started on your next project today. As you have seen, this one came also with a heap of user manuals. Not all of them belong to this particular machine, like the user manual here for the IBM XT, which still carries an original diagnostics floppy disk. I also got both the 1983 and 1984 revisions of the IBM Basic User's Guide, a financial accounting software, the P3 word processor, and even a copy of Windows 386, which of course wouldn't run on this particular machine. Unfortunately, none of the manuals included the floppy disks. That would really have been awesome to get the original disk media as well. Plus, I also got this printer, which I'll have another more detailed look at another time. For today, I'll focus on the PC AT for the most. And here I'll start with the usual disassembly and teardown, along with a good level of cleaning. That's necessary, especially as the mainboard has accumulated lots of dust. Something tells me the innards of the power supply and also the monitors won't look any different. For the mainboard in particular, I'll apply a good amount of electronics cleaner so I can dissolve all that dirt and brush it off before rinsing it underwater. Yet the case as well needs a lot of cleaning. But the positive thing is, there's absolutely no rust or anything. Underneath all that dirt and patina, it looks surprisingly good. I'll also remove those cork pads from the underside, as I'll replace them with new ones eventually. Then I'll give it a shot using just the mainboard and graphics card connected to see if something blows or not. You'll notice that I connected the hard drive to the power supply, but I left away the disk controller. That's because the IBM AT power supply needs a load draw of around 7 amps on the 12 volts rail, otherwise it won't turn on. But it seems to turn on and I get a lot of error messages. So for certain the CMOS battery is dead, but the mainboard is functional from a general point of view, and even so is the 5151 MDA display. But one should not let those running for extended periods of time, in particular not if you're expecting to find lots of dust inside. So I was opening up the PSU and… yeah, There's no way around it to disassemble it and give it a good level of cleaning as well. I won't be doing a full recap now, as I'm typically doing that only on an as-needed basis. Still, getting all the dust out is a necessity, as I don't want it to catch fire. And there's no question about either of the two CRTs I've got. While both are 5151 monochrome displays, they're from different periods, one from 1982 and the other from 1985. Not surprising, both have accumulated a good level of dust inside and even some discoloration for this unit here. Even so, I tried hard to remove the stains, the inside yellowing mostly remained. At least I could get it mostly cleaned on the outside. I'll certainly be conducting an extended burn-in test to see if I need to do a recap on these monitors. At the time, both CRTs function just fine, so I'll leave it at that for now. But if you watch closely, you can see some faint ghost image on this CRT. Both actually exposed the same, so these were most likely used as stationary devices for extended periods of time, which caused the image to eventually burn in. At this point, I was ready again to reassemble the PC AT, which also included the addition of a replacement CMOS battery. And then I thought to swap some components across my IBM PC and PC XT machines. As you can see here, I had the slightly bigger display connected to the IBM PC. That's the 5153 color graphics display, which goes with the CGA graphics card equipped in this machine. The IBM XT, on the other hand, as well, has a 5151 monochrome display, however, it's equipped with this ATI Wonder 800, which is actually an EGA graphics card, but can be configured using DIP switches to support lower resolution monitors. And last but not least, this graphics card here is not the original IBM MDA graphics card, but actually a third-party model featuring the TD3088A chip. And while this is a monochrome graphics card that works well along with the 5151 display, this is actually a Hercules compatible graphics card. Hercules Computer Technology brought their HGC adapter in 1982 to expand on the original IBM PC's graphics capabilities. Even so, IBM had announced the eventual availability of the color graphics adapter, it didn't become available until March 1983. Hercules, on the other side, added monochrome graphics support for resolutions up to 720 by 348 pixels along with the 5151 display, something that was not possible with the original IBM MDA adapter. Hercules graphics eventually became a de facto standard and widely supported, claiming an 18% market share in the graphics card market by 1986. Said that, I was about to perform a switcheroo here. First, I removed the CGA and EGA graphics card from the IBM PC and PC XT respectively. Then I seated the Hercules compatible monochrome display adapters into both machines. As neither of the two machines have a software configurable CMOS setup yet, the system configuration must be set by the DIP switches on the mainboard to indicate the use of a monochrome display adapter. My goal here was, in order to sort of depicting the timeline and evolution, to have both machines use monochrome graphics and the matching 5150 CRT displays. Actually, I'd like to equip the EGA graphics card to the IBM PC AT, however, I'm lacking the 5154 EGA monitor. Hence, I'll equip the CGA graphics card and hook up the 5153 CGA monitor instead. At a future occasion, I'll do another switcheroo with the IBM XT, as my goal is to have the IBM PC with the MDA graphics option, the PC XT with the CGA graphics, and PC AT with the EGA option. But for now, I'll keep it like this, with the earlier machines on MDA and the PC AT with the CGA option. For the latter, there is actually still a switch on the mainboard which must be set depending on the installed graphics option. However, as the PC AT has a software configurable CMOS, it's time to booting off the diagnostics floppy, which also includes the CMOS setup. And this is necessary, as by default it runs in 40 columns mode. That's good if you have bad eyesight, but I prefer to rather use 80 columns mode. To change it, it's required to run through the CMOS setup. This way, the machine is almost ready to install Microsoft Windows, as with a 20 MB hard drive, it offers plenty of room and the CGA graphics option satisfied the minimum requirement for running Windows. Of course, having only 512 KB of RAM equipped, it's maybe a bit tight for Windows. But I'm holding this add-in board in my stock since a good while now. It came from my brother-in-law who had it laying around. Now, this is a 512 KB memory expansion board and this can be used to top off the 512 KB base memory. Multiple of these cards can be equipped to the system, whereas you must set these dip switches for the memory offset. The memory offset defines the starting point where the extra memory is added. In my case, I want to expand from 512 KB to 1 MB, so I set the offset being 512 KB for the starting address. On the next startup, the AT would complain about memory size mismatch, so it's again required to boot off the diagnostics floppy disk to update the memory configuration. And voila, no more startup error message, and the system now has a full megabyte of RAM at hand. Next time on the Vintage Collector. It would have been the perfect day had I suddenly encountered a failure on the PSU, needing me to temporarily hook up a spare 80 style power supply, but also care for these blown capacitors on the disk controller board. Yet, the system still failed on locating the hard drive, leaving me in fear of a disk failure.